practice. I have hardly been in Delhi since the budget. In that post budget, I've been to Dubai, Singapore, I've been to
gentlemen, I just want to thank you all once again for coming out here today and joining us at Ashwamedh Ilara India Dialogue 2016. It's been an absolute pleasure all day hosting this for you and listening to some of our most influential speakers and thought leaders. We have one final discussion for today and we'd like to get started. In the run-up to the Union Budget, Prime Minister Narendra Modi announced an audacious target of doubling farm income by 2022. And the budget followed up with a distinct but differentiated rural positioning. This has set a frenzy of debate about the rationale of the government's commitment to rural India. At our level, this has set the ball rolling for searching for new investment opportunities conditional of this revolutionary promise. To discuss our dialogue number 5 of the day, doubling farm income issues and priorities, we've brought together an esteemed panel of experts. Please join me and give a round of applause in welcoming Dr. Ashok Gulati, Infosys Chair Professor for Agriculture, ICREA. Our next panelist, let's please welcome Swaminathan Iyer, Consulting Editor, Economic Times, once again on stage. And next, I'd like to welcome on stage Ashok K. Bhattacharya, Editor of Business Standard, who will be moderating this discussion for us. It's over to you, gentlemen. Thank you.
thank you. The subject of this one-hour-long discussion is doubling farm income, issues and priorities. And as the lady explained, this is starting off from what the Prime Minister Narendra Modi talked about before the budget, that farm income should be doubled. And we have actually the foremost agricultural economist and the foremost economic journalist to discuss this issue. So let me get into it straight without much ado. Dr. Gulati, my primary question to you is, why doubling farm income? Is it too low a target or too high a target?
Well, it's a dream, what he said.
Okay.
That this is a dream that when India celebrates 75 years of independence in 2022, that is 6 years from now, he would like to see farmers' income doubled. The rationale of this, to the best of my understanding, comes from the fact, if you recall, BJP manifesto before the elections had promised that they will make farmers' profitability 50% above cost.
Mm-hmm.
And when we worked out what the profitability structures were around that time, for most of the crops, they hovered between 20% to 30%. But over 2 years, what had happened was profitability collapsed to 5% or even below, and many crops are in negative.
Mm-hmm.
No BJP leader today wants to talk about that promise.
Mm-hmm.
And with this back-to-back drought and tumbling prices, farmers and farm distress has been increasing.
Mm-hmm.
My understanding politically or economically is in the rural areas, the base which were strong supporters of BJP and also had high expectations from the Prime Minister. They got disillusioned, disappointed, and now 70%, 80% of them farmers are annoyed.
Yeah.
So the political base was
shifting,
drifting. And given that realization, I think internally, politically, they have done the calculation. Mm-hmm. And what they are saying is we should now have another promise. Mm-hmm. And that promise is the dream promise that we will double your incomes. Now, where is the catch? He did not specify whether he is talking in terms of real incomes or nominal incomes. Normally, when we talk about a sectoral growth and others, it's the real income. Mm-hmm. If we are talking of doubling real incomes in 6 years, that requires a compound annual rate of growth of 12% per annum.
A nominal rate, basically.
In real terms.
Okay.
If you want to double the incomes,
that's right.
In real terms.
6 years.
12% in 6 years, compound. Now, 12% rate of growth in agriculture is almost unheard of at a national level. So it's almost next to impossible. But at a state level, impossible has been made possible by certain states. If you look at what has happened to Madhya Pradesh in the last 5 years, the agriculture real GDP growth is 14% per annum. So they have done it. 10 years growth has been hovering around 10% per annum. So there are certain states, but at an all India level, last 2 years, agri GDP has grown at less than 0.5%. To be exact, 0.45% is the average rate of growth. So how do we give this promise? Real, it's the biggest challenge. It will be a miracle of miracles if it happens. So we come to nominal. Is he talking in terms of nominal? Then you look at the last 5 years of UPA government, 2009-10 to 13-14, they have already doubled the income, nominal incomes were doubled. Agriculture wholesale prices of food articles increased by more than 11% per annum. Agri GDP was growing at 3 point something and total was 14%. So you can, nominal income can be increased. So if it is nominal income, he is doubling in 6 years, that's not a big challenge. UPA did it in 5 years. If he can still maintain the food prices at less than 5% and give us 6-7% growth in agriculture real, it will be still a great commendable job.
Okay.
I feel if 6% price and 6% or 5% growth in agri GDP, he can do it. Top it with diversification, top it with non-farm employment, it is feasible. We can discuss more details, but these will be my opening remarks.
Great, thank you.
Nation needs clarity, real income or nominal income.
Okay,
first.
Good.
And how to do it, we'll discuss.
That's right. Let me come to you, Swami. I mean, I think Dr. Gulati explained it in an excellent, you know, the differentiation between nominal and real and the growth challenges. From an economist point of view, even if you take a nominal growth target, which is, as we saw, it was achievable in the last 5 years of UPA, what are the implications of nominal growth, which takes you doubling the income from the agricultural sector? I mean, it means that prices of food products, they go up substantially. Now, do you think that that kind of a scenario can be absorbed in our kind of polity, or are there other challenges that the government, the economy has to face?
No, first, political slogans are not meant to be taken seriously.
Okay.
So, you know, to take this particular thing seriously at this point of time is already endowing the topic with more importance
more respect
than it deserves. The other question is, you know, when we talk about farm income, a farmer is not really concerned about the total value of his output. I mean, when Ashok is talking about increasing production, production is top line. The farmer is more concerned with the bottom line.
See.
The farmer doesn't mind if his yield falls, provided his income doubles. Na?
Yeah.
So what he's really concerned about is the price factor. Yeah. Now what happened was that between 2005 and 2008, there was this huge increase in global prices.
That's right.
which we did not, obviously, in India you couldn't double the prices overnight, but over a period of years. So there was a huge shift in the terms of trade to the farmer. Agricultural prices rose much faster. That era has ended. It had to end at some point of time. It has coincided with two droughts. I will simply say that because of this combination, the farmer's net income has been squeezed so badly that just with one good monsoon, you may double his income. It may not even need 5 years. No, all I can say is, you know, you need to distinguish between the farmer's net income and the output, which are two different concepts. So there has been enormous distress because of two droughts. And I think if you now, the luck turns the other way, maybe he will get rid of that particular as a political problem. The other question of increasing yields is a much more complicated thing. I think that will take some time to discuss. The most obvious way, obviously, is irrigation. Because clearly, if you want to increase yields, irrigation is the way to go. Our current forms of irrigation is the most third-rate, inefficient forms of utilizing water anybody can think of. We have flood irrigation. I mean, you go to America, nobody flattens the land and then fills it with water. You use sprinkler, you use drip, you know, the land in America is like this. It's not flattened. And that land is yielding six times as much in terms of corn yields than the Indian thing is. So what we have got used to the idea is that the water is free. It falls in the monsoon. I make my land flat and, you know, it's full of water. And then why do we grow rice in standing water? You don't need standing water for rice. The reason we do it is that only rice will come through the water and the weeds will get suppressed. So believe it or not, we are wastefully using water as a weedicide instead of using as a plant nutrient.
Maybe we should price the water correctly.
No, you need to change the whole practice. I would ban flood irrigation or very heavily tax it. If we shift entirely from gravity, we are depending on two things. One is gravity flow. The canal system, and the other is flood irrigation. Both are stupid. We have to shift to pumped systems. If you have pumped systems, then instead of having canals, you will have pipes. I went to Gujarat recently for the Narmada project. You build the male canals. All the distributaries have to be built to the command area, which has not been built. Why? One reason is farmers say the price of land is so high, I am not going to give up my land for the building of the distributaries. Because now that is so valuable, you don't want to. So they've taken a decision in principle that all the distributors will now be done by pipe.
So some progress there.
No, all I can say is it needs a complete change in mindset. And this has ultimately been done not because it's technically sensible, which it is, but because farmers are not allowing you, which is a very stupid way of doing it. So if the moment you say that water is going to be delivered under pressure by pipes, and therefore you switch to sprinkler and drip irrigation and you stop flood irrigation, the same water can irrigate twice to three times the area. So these are the ways to go.
Absolutely. So, I mean, what we sort of clearly can see is there's irrigation use, better use of technology for irrigation is one way out. Dr. Gulati, what could be, in your opinion, I mean, if you set apart the feasibility or the logic of deciding whether it is real income or nominal income, or whether it is the top end, top line, or the bottom line, even if you assume that it is you are going to have doubling the income as a target after 6 years, what would be the three most important things Indian agriculture must see, apart from, of course, irrigation?
Let me give a flavor of 1 minute on irrigation, taking from where Swami ended. You know, we have slogan of Har Khet Ko Pani, Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sichai Yojana. The allocation in this budget is 5,767 crores. Now with this money, if we want to give water to every farmer, that's not a game changer at all. It's more a slogan on that. But all said and done,
I mean, the money is too small.
It's too small. It's the states that play a much 10 times bigger role in irrigation investments than what the center is doing. So center doesn't have much. But what is happening in states on irrigation? Take the case of Maharashtra. Last 10 years, they spent 121,000 crores at 14-15 prices. But the irrigation went up only by a little. The cost of public irrigation in Maharashtra, 10th and 11th plan, when you work it out, comes to 20 lakhs per hectare of potential utilized. 20 lakhs per hectare. Now, even the interest on that, if you take it and give it to the farmer, he doesn't need any irrigation. So the question is, where is the money going?
Yeah.
And that's. But let me go further. Irrigation, yes, the direction is right and it is critical, and we must learn how to use water properly. Maharashtra's sugarcane is the biggest thing. You don't have drinking water in Marathwada,
and
but
you're growing
sugar factories. 1 kilogram of sugar means 2,000 liters of water. So entire debate on IPL and this pitch, which is going to take 20 lakh liters of water, it's only 3 tons of sugar. 32,000 rupees per ton is the cost of it, and you can take it and give 5 times to the farmers and compensate. Anyway, let me go beyond irrigation, because Punjab has 97% area under irrigation. Why they are in distress today? So irrigation can give and increase your income, as Madhya Pradesh has done, as Gujarat has done, when they are starting from a very low base. Last 10 years, Madhya Pradesh doubled its irrigation from 21% to 42% of the area. But Punjab, which is sitting at 97% irrigation, it is stagnating because they have failed to diversify further from wheat and rice. So cereals will not give them as much income as many of the high value products, fruits, vegetables, livestock, poultry, all this. So I think the future, if you want to double income, you have to diversify, not only within the farm economy, but also outside the farm economy. Because agriculture of tomorrow is not farming alone, it's a full value chain. So you need to connect and create value chains, like we did in milk. But in fruits and vegetables, there are 20 commodities. So we need Operation Flood type in fruits and vegetables for 20 commodities.
Right.
And that's where you can enlarge the income. And then you can also employ people in building those chains in the rural areas, but off-farm economy. So that's where incomes can multiply. So irrigation, diversification within the farming, and diversification outside the farming, but still in rural areas in building. I think these are the ways in which you can double at least the nominal income. And if prices bounce back, then of course without doing anything you will double the income.
But Ashok, I would like to ask you one thing. This is a question of the yields. We are supposed to have very good scientists, very good agricultural universities. Why are Indian yields of most crops, including rice and maize, wheat, why are they so low compared with that of other developing countries?
Well, I would say major other countries than we compare with. In case of rice, if you are taking, let's say you are comparing with even Bangladesh, and some portions are low, but some portions like Punjab are high. China is a good comparator because India aspires to be China in 10 years, 15 years, whatever. And most of our yields are 50 to 75% of the Chinese levels. I'll give you one example. China's rice, from 29 million hectares, they produce about 145 million tons of rice. 63% of their area is under hybrid rice. Ours, less than 5% area is under hybrid rice. So there is a problem there. So you need seeds besides irrigation, better seeds, more hybrids means higher likelihood of yields. So if our R&D is falling way behind, all the three big revolutions in agriculture in the last 15 years, the biggest was cotton revolution, we doubled our production in 10 years. It came from outside, BT. We are trying to reverse that gear by putting all sorts of controls, you know it better on that, what is happening. There was another in which we doubled our production, and that is hybrid maize. That's also driven by the private sector. Only thing which came from the government side was Pusa Basmati. 1121 and 1509, and that also increased very fast. Many people say that's not true Basmati, but the way, and our exports from less than half a million tons today hover between 4 to 5 million tons of basmati exports. So seed is a catalyst of higher productivity, and it is supported by higher irrigation and more fertilization. Our fertilizer consumption, 130, 140 kilograms per hectare. China is sitting at 400 kilograms per hectare. But if we want to go jaivik kheti, how are you going to increase yields? You can have some sustainability, but precision agriculture, I feel, is the way forward, where you can use 50% less water, even less fertilizers if you do fertigation. And there are methods. And today, Monsanto has bought Climate Corporation and working with John Deere in US. You can send all the data, check each plot, test the soil, and it will command you how much NPK release has to be there after checking the soil. So the exact what the soil needs, how much water is needed, that will be released. So it is like an autopilot mode. And you drive from Illinois to, you know, Iowa, and you find the yield levels of corn there are 10 to 11 tons per hectare. Our average is 2.5.
So is it technology or?
But why? I can't understand why we are only producing two.
First is hybrid.
But we are doing hybrid. Yeah,
most of the corn in US is GM, which will not allow. Right?
So it is a
same thing, soya, that, and then on top of that, precision agriculture is coming in a big way. So all these things do matter. These are all parts of the same technology. Just water, it's critical. But more critical is the seed. Unless you have the seed, water cannot give you much.
Yeah. And even in the fertilizer use, I guess there is
you know, seed, water, and fertilizer, it's a combination, it's a one package. Now the seed, I think innovations that is coming in seed, you can devise such seeds which require less water. So drought proofing through seed, that is the way technology is going ahead.
Yeah.
You can remove your malnutrition through seed, putting more iron.
Yeah.
Pearl millet already has been released in India with more iron.
Yeah.
So these are the future technologies which can give you better income, better productivity, better nutrition. But then you have to be pro-science. And if you want to go back to Gai Mutra and Gai Goba, fine. Then you have to reduce the population of that time, of Vedic times.
Yeah. I think clearly agriculture is suffering from lack of application of technology and the fertilizer use of practices, and diversified cropping pattern. But surely, you know, we keep talking about need for credit for fertilizer sector. And even this budget talks about increasing the credit availability of the fertilizer sector. Is that also an actor in this game? I mean, what's your sense of that?
Many people here will say, you know, these farmers are getting away with murder. They get the cheapest credit, they don't repay the, you know. Farming cannot be said to be an area which is not being subsidized.
Absolutely.
It is being subsidized.
Correct.
At the end of it all, the fact is, it's not, in many ways, the yields are too low.
So economically, it's not working out.
So, I mean, we need to find ways of reducing the input cost and increasing the output. The efficiency of agriculture has to improve.
Yeah.
So one of them, you know, is why do we use water so wastefully? Because it's free.
Yeah.
Why do we use electricity so wastefully? Because it's free.
Yeah. So it's a vicious cycle. The productivity is low.
I'm merely saying agriculture cannot be taken forward by making things cheaper and cheaper and cheaper to the farmer. You need to have a proper costing of the water, a proper costing of the urea. You need a proper costing of the electricity. I mean, if you don't cost these things, you are converting agriculture into a political commodity where there is no relationship between the global input prices and output prices and the Indian input prices, and everything is politics.
Yeah.
And it's up to the politician. And if you get elected, Mr. Raman Singh will declare a bonus of 270 rupees a quintal per rice. And then the consequence of that is, instead of Chhattisgarh getting all the rice from Orissa begins to come into Chhattisgarh.
That's right.
Mr. Chauhan had this big bonus for wheat. All the wheat from Uttar Pradesh began to come into Madhya Pradesh. I mean, all these are completely wasteful things in terms of total resource allocation arising out of political pricing. Absolutely. So you have to get away from this.
So how do you get out of it?
Let me give you a global perspective on subsidies.
Yeah.
It's very interesting because we look at fertilizer subsidy or credit subsidy we talk about that. OECD countries, the way subsidies are measured, it's called the producer subsidy equivalent, PSEs, either through output prices or through input prices. At present, roughly last year's numbers are about 17% of the value of agriculture. That is what is the level in OECD countries.
Is a subsidy.
Subsidy. China, which used to be only 2%, has gone to 19%. As subsidy levels of the value of agriculture. Now, OECD has not measured for India because the government of India did not work, but we have some numbers around that which hover between 6 to 8%. So we are not outrageously out of line. But getting back to something interesting, Swami's point of credit subsidy.
Yeah.
You know, this budget provided 15,000 crores as interest subvention subsidy. You know, that is what created a misnomer as if the
which is how the budget outlay went up.
Outlay went up in agriculture, but it was a transfer entry from Department of Financial Services to agriculture. But we worked out, and if you permit me to do a commercial,
please.
The piece will be coming on Monday.
Yeah.
We are exposing that out of this 15,000, it's very interesting, people are not aware perhaps, that how much are the pending bills already of the banking industry which have not been paid because of this. In 14-15, FY15, it was 35,000 crores.
Not been
paid. And if this is not cleared, then by FY17, you are going to have more than 50,000 crores under the carpet. 15,000 is in the budget, 50,000 crores is under the carpet. That's the level. Now, why that is happening? And they say agriculture credit is growing at 18% per annum for the last 5 years. But that's not reflected in the growth of agriculture. So what is happening? This 7% and 4%. Agriculture, farm credit, short term, production credit, they get at 7%, and if the farmers are regular in repaying, then they get at 4%. So he says, great, I take 3 lakh rupees at 4% credit, and in the same bank, he deposits at 8% fixed deposit. 1 lakh he uses, 2 lakhs he deposits, it's a cool. Banks are also fine that, you know, in a way, this is secure.
So it's way,
it can't default. Or become a money lender to give at 15%, 20% to those who don't have. ADIS data says that 44% of the loans in agriculture are from the non-institutional sources. They don't go to the banks. And the total loan which the banks are showing, 8,40,000 crores, is bigger than 110% of the total value of all agriculture inputs used in the country. So the two things, there is a diversion of about 30 to 40% of agriculture credit into non-agriculture users. And that is because you are trying to subsidize, you know, the biggest flaw, whether it is fertilizer subsidy, whether it is food subsidy, whether it is agriculture subsidy in India, we had that great socialist philosophy that Indians are poor, so keep the output prices low. Now, if you keep the output prices low, farmers need some incentive, therefore subsidize their inputs. The moment you subsidize, then the inefficiency in the use of resources, whether it is power, whether it is water, whether it is fertilizer, you look at NPK ratio, it is massive. So I think the biggest bold move that you need to do, and if you want to double or even triple the income, only one thing I would say. Food subsidy in the current budget is 130,000 crores. People are not aware that 70,000 crores plus are the unpaid bills of FCI. So actual food subsidy is more than 2 lakh crores. Fertilizer subsidy in the budget is 70,000 crores. Unpaid bills to the fertilizer industry are more than 40,000 crores. So you have actually a bag of 300,000 crores.
Yeah, 3 lakh crores.
And you are giving to Prime Minister's Krishi Sichai Yojana 5,767.
Yes.
You are putting the cart before the horse. So all this, just make one policy switch instead of price policy, that is subsidy, because 46% of PDS thinks food does not reach the beneficiaries. There was a big fight, and one newspaper carried John Dres versus Ashok Gulati, and John Dres said he hasn't counted this, he hasn't counted this. Actual number is not 46% leakage, but 42% leakage. Okay, Baba, 42% leakage. 42% leakage if you take, and still you are continuing with that 2 rupee, 1 rupee, you are creating all the incentives for diversion.
Yeah.
Make direct income payments to farmers' accounts.
Hmm.
Direct income payments to consumers' accounts. We worked it out, you will save at least 50,000 crores every year without giving up your objective function to help the farmer or the consumer. And this 50,000 crores you put in irrigation, but also put some governance structures in place so that money doesn't disappear as water disappears in sand. You know, Maharashtra case, 20
yeah.
lakhs
yeah,
rupees
yeah.
per hectare, there is something.
It looks very fairly simple the way you explained it, but why is it not been accepted? Why is it not government doing it?
In principle, they are starting to recognize that. In fact, I had the privilege to give a presentation to the PM on that, and his reaction was, yes, it needs to be done.
Mm-hmm.
And he started off some pilots.
Okay.
But those pilots are still at a very, very small scale. Puducherry, Chandigarh, just to pass time. And today's news was that in Bihar, I think in one of the districts, Purnia, one block, they are going to do DBT on food subsidy. So today we have the mechanism through which we can. I think the biggest thing that he did was opening Jan Dhan accounts.
That's right.
Some deposits also came, which was not expected.
Mm-hmm.
But half of the accounts are dormant.
Mm-hmm.
And you can start putting this food fertilizer subsidy in these things. I think you can make a very vibrant change. And for the better, because first you will plug those leakages. Second, you will save out of this and create efficiency. Let the prices be determined by markets and help those whom you want to help through an income policy rather than through price policy. Because pricing, subsidization leads to inefficient use of resources.
So if that is accepted, so what would be your dream like? Is doubling the income or trebling the income?
I say if 5 years he can do that, this country will be producing at least 50% more production and definitely 70-80% more incomes, 100% more incomes.
Well,
definitely.
I hope
in real terms even.
I hope the Prime Minister is listening.
Within 5 years, this country can do that.
Fantastic.
Provided you remain focused and you make sure, this is the big dinosaur, 300,000 crores.
Yeah. That's right.
I think I have to enter a pessimistic note here.
Yeah, please.
The problem is that this is not an economic issue, it's a political economy issue.
Yeah, that's also true.
The reason why subsidies have come in is not that some great and wise person decided this is the way. Competition between political parties keeps driving those subsidies higher.
Yeah.
So my real fear is that somebody will say, Ashok, splendid idea.
Mm.
We will give all the money in a transfer. But over and above that, we will continue with these subsidies. And if they don't, the other party will offer larger subsidies.
Because the bureaucracy has...
No, it's not just the bureaucracy. The political competition between parties is how do I show that I am more pro-farmer than the other fellow.
That's right.
So my real problem is that technically speaking, it is certainly a good fix that instead of subsidizing the item, I will subsidize the individual. But if you only subsidize the individual, another party will come and say, look at that heartless son of a bitch. I will both give that and subsidize the item. Please vote for me.
That's wonderful. Just one issue that we need to discuss, which I, when we talk about agriculture and farm income, are we ignoring that section of the I would say the larger farming sector, which is probably grown bigger than the traditional agriculture, which is dairy, poultry, animal husbandry. I mean, and when we are doing that, are we ignoring the needs of that sector and what needs to be fixed there? Because that's also a growing sector and probably, you know, if you, you know, that.
No, that sector is doing well. I mean, it's under the radar because, you know, precisely because it is resilient in a drought. I mean, the reason why we are getting, I mean, I became a journalist in 65. In 65 and 66, when we had two successive droughts, this country was starving, and that, you know, you needed every ship full of food aid from America to prevent people from dying. Today, two droughts in a row, and guess what? India is the world's largest exporter of rice. I mean, look at the transformation. So yes, there are pockets of distress here and there, right? So as journalists, we, you know, we need headlines. So you will send out people to Latur, and you will send out people to Bundelkhand. But what about the rest of the country? Moreover and above that, a huge amount of agriculture has moved into these new areas. So if you've got into animal husbandry, if you've got into milk production, if you've got into fisheries, various other things, all of these things are resilient in a drought. So this is the reason why we can have a major drought and agricultural production still increases.
So this happened on its own, transition?
No. I think the revolution starts in your thali.
Okay.
Okay, because when you become better off, you don't go from four chapatis to six chapatis or this much rice to this much rice. That reduces, and what adds in your thali is the high value. Whether it is chicken, whether it is curd, whether it is milk and fruits and vegetables. So that's where the growth has to follow. This is the demand-driven growth, and that's the right way to go. So today, 50%, you know, agriculture policy means wheat and rice in this country. But entire food grains, all cereals plus pulses, account for less than 23% of the value of agriculture output. Less than 23%. But policy domain, it is 80%, wheat and rice.
That's right.
So I think there is a big mindset that needs to change. In case of milk, because there was huge shortage and we had Operation Flood and something got fixed. But still we are processing. We are today the largest producer of milk in the world. And how did we do that? I'll just give you one example.
Without government intervention?
1951. India was producing only 17 million tons of milk, and US at that time was 53 million tons, roughly three times ours. US today is 91, 92 million tons of milk, and we are at 147 million tons of milk. And this is done all not by huge, big players, but by pygmy farmers with two and four cows and buffaloes and this and that. And still we are processing through the organized sector only 20% of our milk. 80% is yet to be. So massive investments, and it was done through Operation Flood to start with. But fruits and vegetables, that type of initiative and that type of big bang never happened. We are the second largest producer of fruits and vegetables.
So why is it not happening?
I mean, this is, because the priority, you hear so much of make in India. You don't have a lion here, you have a horse here. But why not make food into more processed item? Less than 5% of our fruits and vegetables are being processed. You go to Southeast Asia, 25 to 50%. You go to Europe, US, 70%, 75%. So there is a huge chain, value chain that needs to be created. Government can be a catalyst of change, but many of the laws need to be changed to invite private sector investment. They can come, provided you clear the rules of the game. Rules of game are not very clear, and it's a very restrictive.
I think like milk. Immediately it's going into a kind of refrigerated van, the cold chain begins and it's managed. In the case of fruits and vegetables, now if you want reliable cold storage and thing, you must have 24/7 rural electricity. If you have a situation where, because rural electricity is free, you can only afford to give it for 6 hours a day, how do you create a cold chain? And then you get a logistics. Bharti went in for saying, I'm going to do agricultural exports. He says he managed the cold chain all the way till the airport, but at the airport there was no facility. And for 6 hours the thing was without refrigeration. And by the time you put it on the airport, at that point the entire consignment went bad. And Bharti's entire experiment in agriculture export course. So, you know, you must have electrical and godown systems which are commercial. The moment everything is politically decided and not commercially decided, you are going to get these problems. In the case of milk, we managed to overcome it.
Yeah.
Basically because Operation Flood was funded entirely by gifts of milk powder to the cooperative system, which they sold commercially, so they didn't have to depend on government funding. You know, they said, keep the bloody government out and solutions are possible.
So before IT, it was milk.
Yes.
I think one subject which we haven't discussed is, and we keep talking about it, and we've been talking about it for the last several years, is contract farming. Why do you think contract farming has not really picked up in this country, and is that a way forward?
You may call it the Vijay Mallya syndrome. I talked to Nachiket Moore, who did quite a lot of this contract farming for ICICI Bank.
Yeah.
So you enter into the contract with the farmer,
yeah,
that you will supply this particular crop at 100 rupees
yeah.
a kilo.
Yeah.
Nachiket says, if the price goes from 100 to 100 rupees and 1 paisa, not a single ton will be delivered to me. It will all be sold in the open market. Because as far as the farmer is concerned,
he is just
cheating the urban man is highly moral and respectable. Suppose on the other hand, he says, the price falls from 100 rupees to 99. At that point, the farmer buys up all the produce from all his neighbors, claims it's his, and sells it to you at 100. So, you know, the contract farming depends on a notion of sanctity of contract.
Okay.
As far as the farmer is concerned, there is no sanctity.
Okay.
Now, how you overcome this? Now, in some things you can overcome it. I mean, suppose there's a particular seed that you are supplying, then
yeah.
and he has to give it back. You have an advantage. Suppose it's a highly perishable commodity, you might be able to do it. But for a large number of bulk commodities, it turned out to be impossible. Now, the question arises, like in the case of Operational Flood, is it possible to organize them in the form of some kind of cooperative which works properly? I know people who have tried it, and to the best of my knowledge, nobody has succeeded on a large scale today. The amount of trust required,
yeah.
the amount of organization required, so far has failed. And this is a very major issue.
Okay. What's your perspective on this?
I'll give you something interesting.
Yeah.
One of the biggest multinational beverage, Pepsi.
Hmm. Yes, they were
in West Bengal.
West Bengal, yeah, potato.
They are doing potatoes
yeah.
with about 15,000 farmers,
right.
they claim.
Yeah. Mm.
And I wanted to do a study of that.
Mm-hmm.
And Vivek, I said, Vivek, can we bring it and highlight how this is being done? Because you are one of the big players and mm-hmm. smallest farmers, and that too in West Bengal.
Yeah.
It's a perfect case how to show how contract farming can work.
Yeah.
Now, don't call it contract farming. It's contact farming. They have resolved that price issue.
Yeah.
You know, whatever they say, whatever is the market price going on, we'll give a little more than that. Because they can absorb in the value addition that they do, they can easily absorb that. Similarly, ITC used to do through Chopal and all that in case of soybean. So, you know, first you have to allow. If I go and directly buy from the farmer without bypassing the APMC mandi, it's illegal in most of the states.
Yeah, absolutely. Because many states have not passed the APMC
so
Act.
So I think we have to clean up all that mess of market reforms
mm-hmm.
so that directly, because farming and the processor and the logistic players, all these people and the organized retail
mm-hmm.
have to fall in line.
That's right.
Only then you can reduce the risk.
Okay.
We kept on fighting on organized retail for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Now we are allowing, okay, e-commerce will come with 100% FDI.
Mm-hmm.
Processing, our levels are very, very low.
Nobody is talking about FDI in agriculture.
No.
Not yet.
Even you can't buy land. Mr. Amitabh Bachchan tried to buy land in UP and you know he had to return it back. So you can't declare yourself as a farmer.
Yeah, that's right.
So
yeah.
all these restrictions, I think a cleaning up of many of these laws
yeah.
which are outdated mm-hmm. and freedom has to be given to do business in that. I think that sense.
Okay.
The government acts as my bop, but then it becomes more a rentier class rather than a business-friendly class.
That's right.
So, that's
so I mean, we have just a few minutes left for this session to come to an end. There are questions from the floor. Please raise your hand, identify yourself, and please be brief in your question if you can. Is there a mic there?
Can we have the mic? Hi sir, this is Nikunj Doshi from Bay Capital.
Yeah, stand up please if you don't mind.
Spoke about contract farming, but what about corporate farming? Means corporates can buy land on lease or something and aggregate land parcels, and they can do much more mechanization and effective farming, efficient farming. So what's your view or take on that? Is it possible in India anytime?
You know, there are two aspects of this corporate farming. One is I am allowed as a corporate to buy land and do my business. Now that you can do in plantations, your coffee or tea and all that. But not in the rest of agriculture. By law you are not allowed. The other is you can lease in land from the farmers and do a second grade corporate farming, whatever you call it. That effort has been going on to free up the lease markets. Unfortunately, our laws are land to the tiller, so anybody who has been tilling, after 3 years you can't evict that fellow tenant, and therefore laws, farmers feel hesitant to give your land for more than 1 year, 2 years. You know, law is not protecting the owner, it is favoring the tenant. In this case, the tenant will be the corporate, and therefore they have more muscle power, tenant law also, so the land will be gone forever. So we need to do the land lease cleaning up. I think Niti started off a paper on that, and within that there is discussion, but states are still not ready.
Yeah, it was announcement was also made on land leasing.
It's a very touchy, I think, because of the other land acquisition problem. Yeah. Now land has become a very, very touchy thing.
Swami, you want to say something on this?
No. I agree with that.
Yeah, sure.
But interestingly, you know, China, where of course all the land owner is the state, but user rights are with the farmers, farmers are now allowed to lease out for 30 years to corporates, to anybody else. 30 years. So I think we have to change our system towards that direction. But you have to protect the owner.
But I thought land leasing per se has got many safeguards. The kind of framework they're talking about has got many safeguards that protects the landowner. Is that your understanding? I mean, because that's something which is being actually...
You know, they are trying to do that, but our left and Congress still would be pro-tenant rather than pro-owner.
But Ashok, in Punjab, I'm told they actually did change the law 2 years ago. What is the experience till now?
No, this is where I think Bharti was at the back of, you know, two states they worked very closely with, and some changes were done. Farmers still feel that if I give my land, after 3 years I will not get back.
That's right.
Okay.
Any other question?
60 years they had under one law, and suddenly it's...
Any other
question? We'll take one last question.
Yeah, good evening, sir. Shila Ditto from ICSA Prudential Life. Wanted to understand that rural consumption demand has been badly hurt. Even if we have a normal monsoon this time, how does it augur for rural consumption? Do we see a rebound in rural consumption if the monsoon is normal, or we have some more damages which will take time to correct?
Swami, want to?
Couldn't hear it properly.
He's saying that there is a bad rainfall. Even if the rainfall is better, will it have a positive impact on rural demand? Because that is the crucial thing.
No, without doubt.
Yeah. Running around rural economy when you have 2 years of backlog of debts and bad, you know, many things have been waiting for the farmer to spend on number of things and clear off his debts. I think it will take a little more time. It's not just this Kharif. Yeah. Maybe in Rabi. We'll have some.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gulati. Thank you, Swami.
Thank you.
I think we had a wonderful session.
Thank you.
The agriculture could be, the dreaming for the government is fine. Doubling the income and trebling the income is also possible, as our panelists said. But I think the more important element, more than dreaming, would be to make sure that the infrastructure is put in place, legal reforms are initiated in terms of land owning and land leasing, and of course technology, productivity and irrigation. These are the broad areas. And I think with these words, we come to the end of this session. I hand it back to the
Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen, for giving us all those insights into doubling farm income.